NIST is also under non-disclosure agreement. That's in their report. In other words, they can't say too much. So someone above them is putting these constraints on these guys. We offered to sit down with the guys at NIST or debate them, you know, sit down, whatever, talk to them about our concerns. They declined. We had mentioned a specific time and place. And so we said, well, look, you name the time and place. We just think we ought to talk about these problems. I mean, this affects the whole world, really. You know, the weaknesses in your analysis. And I guess I wasn't too surprised. They said a change in venue and a change in time will not change our decision. We're not going to sit down and talk.
I'm Jim Nesch. I've been in the foundry business for approximately 28 years. My expertise is I pour metal. I have a gas-fired furnace. It runs 750,000 BTUs, and I pour all non-ferrous metals, brass, bronze, aluminum. It takes me approximately, in a controlled environment inside the furnace, 45 to 55 minutes to melt brass, which is poured to 1950 to 2000 degrees. Bronze is higher temperature, but I can go to like 2350. I do not pour steel because it's too hot. Crematories are above, like, say 2500 degrees, that people are disintegrated. That if there were people in that building, how did they peek out and look or jump? How were they not melted immediately if they have a heat that intense to warp or mess with the structure of steel? How are the people still alive? It's impossible. To weaken something 50 feet away would have melted you to be in its vicinity. Logically, physically, no way could have caused a collapse in any way. It could not have affected the collapse of the World Trade Center. It's impossible.
After you let the buildings come down, you have to explain this flowing material right at the corner, by the way, which is on the north face of the South Tower. But right there at that corner, this molten metal with the orange glow, yellow-orange glow, flows out for minutes. There's a lot of it. And then right at that corner, you see this weakening, the twisting and the collapse of the building. NIST tries to explain that molten metal, which is yellow-orange color, a lot of material flowing out. They said, well, it's aluminum. That's what they said early on. And then I did experiments with aluminum and silver. So they came back and said, well, aluminum with, you know, wood chips, plastic, carpet, stuff mixed in, that they said, can have an orange glow. Well, the can caught my attention. I immediately was out doing experiments, you know. Molten aluminum, we put in some wood chips and plastic, wood ash from my wood-burning stove, and carpet pieces and glass. I mean, we're just putting all this stuff in there, melt this stuff up, and we have a young professor here who came from NIST. He couldn't believe that NIST would say, you know, if you mix organics with aluminum and pour it out, now it'll have an orange glow. He couldn't believe they'd be wrong, but we couldn't get it. So he was working with me for over an hour, mixing this concoction of molten aluminum with wood, glass, plastic, carpet pieces, mix, and you know, it doesn't want to mix, the organics don't want to mix with the molten aluminum. We just poured it out. He poured it out, actually. Silvery, not orange glow, no orange glow.
I melt aluminum. Aluminum is white colored, silver colored. There is no different colors in it. That's the only color it can be because it's silver colored. To have a different color in there means another chemical has to be involved. There was no melting of any structures below whatever story it was on down. So if something fell, it's going to just land there and stay there. The building's not going to fall down.
On July 28, 1945, the Empire State Building was struck by a B-52 bomber on its way to Newark Airport. It left a hole 18 feet wide and 20 feet high. But the building did not collapse. It was for this reason that the World Trade Towers were built to sustain impacts from several jet airliners.
The building was designed to have a fully loaded 707 crash into it. That was the largest plane at the time. I believe that the building probably could sustain multiple impacts of jetliners because this structure is like the mosquito netting on your screen door, this intense grid. And the jet plane is just a pencil puncturing that screen netting. It really does nothing to the screen netting.
Frank A. DeMartini died in the 9/11 attacks. Lee Robertson, the WTC project structural engineer, also confirmed that the towers were designed to take hits from jet aircraft.
Well, the columns and core were, this was a self-standing core. It was the first thing that went up and the rest of the building was built around it. 47, these are huge columns, 47 of them, and they held the elevator shafts and some service floors and so forth. This was regular construction grade steel, A36 it's called, which means it has 36,000 PSI of yield strength or greater. And so it's typical construction steel, but it's very huge columns. Around the outside of the building were 236 columns that were box columns made of very high-grade steel, like 65,000 PSI steel.
Let's take a look now then at these 14 floors above the damage where the plane came in as a block in the North Tower. And let's do two things. Let's have a giant crane and imagine that picks up 14 floors and just drops them in air. You know, no building below, just drop them in air. How long will it take for the roof to get to the ground when you do that? Well, it works out to just about 9 or 10 seconds. There's some air resistance, but pretty much ignore that. The height of the North Tower, 1,368 feet. If you dropped a steel ball in vacuum, it would drop in 9.2 seconds. So we got this big block. We're doing the same thing, except we're dropping it in air. And, 9 or 10 seconds is what you'd expect. Now, how long did it actually take the building to collapse? Well, it's about 10 seconds, maybe 12. It's a little hard to tell now because there's so much dust. But if you look at the seismic record, when the shaking started, as that building started coming down, when it ends, just about 10 seconds. Okay, now we've done that one experiment. We drop it in air, 10 seconds. Now you take the same block and you drop it over the rest of the tower that's still there. You've got 47 core columns below, 240, these are steel columns going up the center of that thing, huge. At the base, they're 4 foot by 2 foot, steel, okay? Interconnected columns, designed to stay standing, not to just give up, you know, when something hits them. And then you've got 240 perimeter columns. Now you drop that block of 14 stories, okay, above the damage zone. You drop that drop on the rest of the building. What happens? Well, which is going to take longer? The one you drop in air or the one you drop on, you know, a couple hundred thousand tons of steel and concrete that's designed to remain standing? Which is going to take longer? The one that you drop on the building, obviously, should take a lot longer than the one you just drop in air. The situation, when you time it, it's essentially free fall speed. Goodness, how does that happen with all this steel in the way? There's another way of saying that we need to look at conservation of energy and momentum. That analysis has been done by Professor Cutler, professor of mathematics. He comes up with 36 to 40 seconds, just this block hitting stationary matter. And now you throw in the columns, and this gets us to Gordon Ross, a mechanical engineer in United Kingdom. He says you put in the columns and conservation of energy and conservation of momentum. None of those looked at by FEMA and NIST, you see this. His final result is that the upper block will stop. The destruction goes a ways, but then it stops. I mean, why should we assume that the building below just gives up? No. That upper block goes a ways, and then it stops. And it might actually fall off due to asymmetry. That's what you expect. You don't expect it to fall straight down at free fall, near free fall speed, unless you get the material out of the way below. The way that's done.